On this week's show, legislators and Volkswagen agree on how to fix the Dieselgate scandal, Tesla offers customers a month's free autopilot trial, and a Formula E stunt you just have to see to believe. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, April 22nd, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and we've just gone 100% wireless at Transport Evolved headquarters thanks to a six-month loan of the plugless power wireless charging system for the Nissan Leaf electric car. Keep your eyes peeled in the coming weeks, because our first video about this six-month-long loan is on the way. We start today's show with the latest news in the ongoing Dieselgate emissions scandal, namely news of a settlement that's supposedly been reached between the US EPA, the California Air Resources Board, and Volkswagen. While the details of the settlement are confidential among concerned parties and is still only an agreement in principle, and that will mean it'll have to undergo additional public and legal scrutiny, it appears Volkswagen will contact owners of some 482,000 affected 2.0-litre diesel engine Volkswagen and Audi vehicles, offering to either buy back customers' cars or have them modified at Volkswagen's expense to bring them in line with the limits set by the Clean Air Act. Additionally, Volkswagen will waive any lease cancellation fees from owners who lease their cars and want to return them, and it will set up two funds to help recompense those affected by the scandal. The first will offer customers a rumoured $5,000 each in exchange for their agreement not to sue Volkswagen for selling them an illegal vehicle, and the second will help support appropriate remediation efforts to counteract the environmental impact of the non-compliant cars being driven around for the past few years. Looking forward, Volkswagen and the US regulators now have until June 21st to turn that agreement in principle into a legally binding agreement. We'll keep you posted for more developments as and when they happen. Moving away from Volkswagen's Dieselgate scandal, we're off to the state of Michigan now, where Ford spent nearly $200,000 plus taxes to get its hands on a Tesla Model X crossover SUV. As we reminded you on Wednesday this week, buying a rival's car and then dismantling it in order to understand its secrets is common practice in the automotive world. Practically every automaker does it in one form or another. But what's particularly interesting here is that Ford had to jump through some pretty big hoops to get its hands on a Model X. Because Tesla only sells direct to customers, Ford was left paying more than $55,000 over list price just to get a Model X to pull apart. Where did he get the car from? Well, a Michigan dealership, which had purchased the car from a California Tesla Model S owner who had won the right to order a Model X Founders Edition through the first Tesla Model S referral program, but decided he didn't want it. That car is now being pulled apart, and if our sources are correct, it isn't the only Model X to be purchased this way. Earlier this week, we heard that German automaker Audi had purchased its own Model X in a similar fashion, shipping the expensive plug-in to Germany just to get its hands on one. The problem? It didn't have any US-spec Tesla charging stations to plug the car into, and European models are different. Whoops. Staying with Tesla for a second, we heard this week that the California automaker is leveraging its software-centric vehicle design to offer Tesla Model S and Tesla Model X customers with autopilot-ready cars who haven't yet paid for the service to be activated for a month-long autopilot trial. Activated via a simple pop-up on the vehicle's dash of the customer's car, the trial is something of an automotive first as far as we can tell, and is a great way for Tesla to sell customers new products and services without the usual pressure that comes from the automotive upsell. We also note that in the same week, Tesla released a software Easter egg to make it possible for Tesla customers to experience other variants of their car, allowing them to emulate lesser spec Tesla variants with the touch of a button. The emulation system, which allows a Model S P90D owner, for example, to make their car behave like a Tesla Model S 70D, remaps throttle response and could be a great option for use in daily driving if you don't want to continually unleash all of that raw torque under your right foot. Someone no stranger to free trials is Tesla's Silicon Valley rival Apple, which, as we explained on Tuesday this week, has recently hired former Tesla VP of Engineering Chris Porritt to reportedly head its top-secret autonomous electric car project, known only as Project Titan. While the more salacious headlines suggested that Porritt had been poached from Tesla's halls by Apple, the truth of the matter was that Porritt left Tesla back in November last year, before spending a few months doing other things before joining Apple in the last few weeks. Porritt, who you'll see in this video, joined Tesla back in 2014 after a considerable amount of time at British firm Aston Martin. Prior to that, Porritt began his automotive career at Land Rover, where he worked his way through the ranks from an apprenticeship to become principal engineer in vehicle dynamics. While he was at Tesla, Porritt worked on Model S, Model X, and more recently Model 3, so we'll be just interested to see how soon his influence will be felt at one infinite loop, and more importantly, just what Apple's Project Titan will turn out to be. But it isn't the only automaker suffering some brain drain this week either. It turns out that BMW is losing its electric vehicle specialists to pastures new as well. Those new pastures in question? Well, not another well-known Western automaker, but Future Mobility Corp, a Chinese electric vehicle company backed by Tencent Holdings Limited and Foxconn Technology Group. You know, the company that makes most of the stuff you'll find in an Apple iPhone? According to Automotive News, the three executives in question, Dirk Abendroth, Bernard Jakob, and Henrik Wenders, will be joining as vice presidents of software and connectivity, design, and marketing respectively, and will join another ex-BMW staffer, former project manager for BMW i8 plug-in hybrid sports car, Carsten Breitfeld. While you probably don't know any of these men by name, it's worth noting that combined, they played an important role in the development of the BMW i3 and BMW i8, and more importantly, aren't the first BMW iBrand execs to leave for another company. Richard Kim, lead designer of the BMW i3 and BMW i8 concept cars, is now at California automaker Faraday Future. There must be something in that water. Either that, or BMW doesn't do Funtime Fridays or Margarita Mondays. Future Mobility Corp isn't the only company from the People's Republic of China on today's show, because the next story involves Chinese media giant LeEco and the unveiling of its very first autonomous electric car. Driven out on stage during a press presentation in China this week, the car, called deceit, that's capital L, small e, capital S, capital E, capital E, is only a concept car at this stage. However, company CEO Ye Yingting, known to his fans as Ye Jobs, after his Steve Jobs-like dress sense and charisma, says he hopes the car will be launched in the next few years as China's first smart, connected, and automated self-driving car. Think it's not possible? Well, think again. As a major player in the Chinese tech world, LeEco has plenty of fingers in plenty of pies, and certainly seems to have the technical prowess to achieve Jia's grandiose goals and prove itself a worthy adversary in the global automotive marketplace, like so many South Korean and Japanese automakers before it. It's worth noting, too, that LeEco is the principal funding source for California startup Faraday Future and has some ever-increasing ties to luxury British mark Aston Martin. While we're not sure if it has what it takes to tackle Tesla just yet, we certainly think this is a company Elon Musk should be scared of. Changing gear now, we're off to Ohio next, where Japanese automaker Honda let slip on Wednesday this week that it's planning to build a battery electric version of its Clarity full-cell sedan alongside a plug-in hybrid variant we already knew about. As our friends over at Green Car Reports detailed, it's all part of a ploy to ensure that Honda offers customers a range of hybrid, but we note that it may not be available nationwide, leading us to suggest it was probably going to be another compliance car. Still, with seating for five, the mid-size battery electric vehicle could garner itself some serious sales figures, if only Honda gives it the right sticker price. Something that may not be the right price for the market is the Renault Zoe electric car, which will enter the New Zealand market later this year for an eye-watering NZD$75,000, or about $53,000. It's all part of an attempt to kickstart the New Zealand electric car market that will see the Renault Zoe, the Renault Kangoo Z.E, and the Renault Twizy all go on sale there by the end of this year. On paper, the Zoe should be a perfect fit for the island nation, especially given the fact that Renault is treated as something of an upmarket brand there. But the problem here is that New Zealand isn't known for its electric car incentives. In fact, there's not a single electric car incentive offered by the New Zealand government right now, and sales tax, or GST, adds a massive 15% onto the already high sticker price of any new car. We're hopeful Renault will manage to engage buyers, but given the high price, we think it'll be an uphill struggle. Something that Nissan found last year when it pulled its Leaf electric hatch out of New Zealand altogether because it said people just weren't buying the car. Good luck, Renault. Sounds like you might need it. And you might need some blind trust and a heck of a lot of good luck. Talking of blind trust, that's exactly what our final story is about. And we should note before we go any further, this is something that you certainly should not try at home. You see, this is world-renowned free runner, gymnast and stuntman Damien Walters. A former member of the Jackie Chan stunt team, he's the guy behind plenty of Hollywood hit action scenes, including much of the action scenes in movie adaptations of Mark Miller's excellent dark comic classics, Kick-Ass and Secret Service, the latter of which lost its original name and was rebranded Kingsman when it was turned into a movie. And yes, you just learnt that I have a soft spot for ultra-gory comic books. Sorry. Anyway, this past week, a video of Walters jumping over a moving Formula E race car went viral. All he had to rely on was his sensors to ensure that he didn't become a splat on the electrified tarmac. It's truly stunning, mind-blowing, and proves, I guess, that electric cars aren't the silent killers that everyone says they are. Everyone just needs to learn themselves some parkour to make sure they can jump out of the way, eh? Well, that's something I don't think I've got the skill for, but I could probably stretch for a few hours in the gym. This extra flam won't lose itself sitting on the couch. I'll be back next week at the usual time with another episode of T.E.N. And in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolve.com. Catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolve and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. While our team is still pretty small, we are in need of some major investment for new equipment so we can grow to our next level, and that and buy food for everyone and coffee, maybe a new server for Michael to play with. So go on, help us out. As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including news of Washington State's new threshold for electric vehicle sales tax. We discover that the Mahindra E20 has better specifications than we thought it would, but is still woefully underpowered for Europe. Nissan donates 100 electric vehicles to help relief efforts for last week's Japanese megaquake. And Ford explains why it's not interested in making a 200-mile electric car, at least not anytime soon. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.